Hi everyone, my name is Lazaros Gonidis. I'm a lecturer in psychological methods and statistics, and together I will talk to you about some work we've done together with my colleague Dr. Dinka Sharma on time perception in addiction and present you with some evidence across different addictions. So traditionally in attentional bias research in addiction, we would refer to experimental designs including addiction modified Stroop task, dot probe task, among other things, and we would report robust findings of participants' preferential attention to addiction-related stimuli, either in the form of increased reaction time when they report the color in a Stroop task, or delayed disengagement in the case of dot probe task, or even in a Stroop task when we have something we refer to as the slow effect. So our work with Dinka started a few years back when we started investigating internet and Facebook addiction and time perception for my PhD back then, and were the first to report that when exposed to internet and Facebook related stimuli, our perception of time changes, both in terms of bisection point that I will explain a bit later down this presentation, and Weber's ratio. So I wanted to kind of expand from this work. I want to present evidence, and we want to make the argument that actually time perception is a valuable tool that can be used in the study of addiction because it can be grounded to theory in the sense of craving, in the sense of how we react to external cues, and so on. So one theory that can explain behavior in addiction is the elaborate intrusion theory by Cavanna, and that theory includes a theoretical model, a concept on how we react when we are exposed to external cues related to addiction, how these can then lead to anticipatory responses and associated thoughts of use, and they can lead to negative affect and physiological deficit. But more important, they can lead to desired thoughts with implications of wanting to use a specific substance and so on. And we think this is highly related to temporal perception and specifically to internal clock models because their implications can affect how our pacemaker works and how our mood switch works. So all these thoughts, all these related thoughts or desires or urge to use something related to an addiction can have either arousal effects on a pacemaker or attentional effects on the mood switch. So what I'm going to report today is a subset, a small sample of a number of experiments we've done across different addiction-modified temporal bisection task experiments. So what we did is we took the temporal bisection task and we start using it using half stimuli that are addiction related and half neutral ones. And some of the examples we used it in the past include a gambling modified one using gambling related images, alcohol modified one using alcohol, which I will not include today because of the time constraints, smoking modified one with products such as tobacco or even cannabis, and loot boxes modified one, which is a more recent work we've done, but I think it's highly relevant in modern time and day. And I will present you with evidence that they are kind of robust and consistent findings across all these paradigms that can add to the research of addiction, but also to the theory of time perception. So the general methodology we use the temporal bisection task, and for each paradigm, we use relevant images for that specific addiction together with neutral images that they were matched in geometrical and color aspects. And because of the time constraints, I haven't included lots of information here, but during the Q&A session, I'm more than happy to give you more details on the methodological design, on the stimuli we used, how we selected them, and so on. Also today, I'll be focusing on the bisection point analysis and Weber's ratio. I will not be focusing on the P-long. We had lots of statistical findings in the P-long analysis, but I left it out. Again, if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. And we excluded participants with a bisection point outside the 460-100 milliseconds because these were long and short durations, and we used it also as an exclusion criteria. If someone was outside these boundaries, it would mean they would not do the task properly. So for the gambling modified experiment, what we did was we recruited 45 participants, and we know this sample is small, but we think it's really informative. We had significant results, and I think it is really worth talking about it. So we had 20 participants that were frequently poker players, matched with 25 participants that they were controlled. We have a larger control group because initially we recruited 25 poker participants, but unfortunately during the data collection they did not show up, and then we decided to keep the samples as they were. So what we found was significant difference in bisection point values between gambling and neutral stimuli for gamblers condition only. And what we see is for the gambling stimuli, participants tend to underestimate the time compared to the neutral ones, which is an indication, a strong indication of attentional bias effect and impact on the attention switch, the mode switch. But also for Weber's ratio, poker players demonstrate a significantly lower Weber's ratio compared to the control group, which we argue is an effect of arousal. So the poker players got aroused by being exposed to the poker-related stimuli, which led to an increased arousal and then lower Weber ratio value and better temporal discriminability. In another experiment, we use smoking-modified stimuli and neutral ones, and we recruited smokers and non-smokers. And again, we found similar results, significant differences in bisection values between smoking and neutral images only for the smokers. So the attentional bias effect was only present for smokers. This was a larger experiment that also included cannabis stimuli, and we're hoping to recruit lots of participants that would smoke or use cannabis products, but that happened during the COVID outbreak at the beginning of it, so we had to stop data collection, and we did not manage to recruit enough to kind of draw really valuable conclusions. And again, what we see here is this time for the smoking stimuli, we have an overestimation compared to the neutral one. So to a different direction from the gamblers, really, but still differences between the smoking and the neutral stimuli. And no significant Weber ratio differences or any other sorts of interactions. So in conclusion, we only found attentional bias effects here, but to the different direction compared to the gamblers. So for the last experiment, for the loot boxes modified experiment, we recruited a much larger sample of the university students because we did not know how many we will manage to find that they have spent money buying loot boxes. And loot boxes are a form of addiction that we have arguments now saying it should be a new form of addiction because people spend money without having a certain outcome, and they keep gambling until they get a highly valued item. So what did we do then is we compared between participants who had spent money on loot boxes and those who did not spend any money on loot boxes. And we found significant differences again. Again, this time similar to the gambling ones. So we have underestimation of time for game-related objects compared to neutral ones. So the same direction as a gambling addiction, opposite direction as the smoking addiction. And again, no significant WR changes or differences between the groups. So in conclusion, for this experiment, participants who had spent money on loot boxes underestimated durations similar to the gamblers. So what we want to really argue, and we kind of want to inform the research community about that, is we strongly believe that the time perception theory can really add to the investigation of addiction, and specifically the temporal bisection task can be of great value because it can discriminate between attentional effects in the form of bisection point differences and arousal effects in the form of WR differences. There are also some differences across different paradigms. For example, there seem to be a bisection point effect coming out across all of them. The WR not so much, but also the bisection The bisection point effect had a different direction for substance addictions, such as smoking, compared to non-substance addictions, such as gambling and loot boxes consumption. So that was all from me. I know that was kind of in a hurry, but I'm more than happy to give you more details. This is all work that is in the paper we are submitting the Addiction Journal, and we will be more than happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you very much. Thank you.